once again we caution you. These stories are definitely not for the timid soul. So we tell you calmly and very sincerely, if you frighten easily, turn off your radio now.
Boss.
Yeah?
Boss, ain't you going to bed?
Not right now.
Ain't you planning on going to bed in the near future?
No.
You ever going to bed?
No.
Well, I ain't sleepy either.
Good, now have a drink.
No, not me, boss.
Don't have a drink.
Boss, let's get out of here.
No, sir. I'm waiting for a lady.
Please, boss, let's go. Ain't nothing but trouble for you here.
Coming back? I know she's coming back.
We'll take the car and drive all night. We'll get drunk. We'll go fishing and stay away until she's gone.
Shut up and go home, will you?
No, sir. I'm staying right here.
I grab Bugatti, then she walks in. Well, where it goes. One in, one out. Sam.
Yes, boss.
It's December 1941 in Casablanca. What time is it in New York?
What? My watch stopped.
I bet they're asleep in New York. I bet they're asleep all over America. Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, she walks into mine. What's that you're playing?
Oh, just a little something of my own.
Oh, stop it. You know what I want to hear.
No, I don't.
You played it for her, you play it for me.
Well, I don't think I can remember.
If she can stand it, I can. Play it.
Yes, boss.
Material Podcast. I'm Tom Carnell.
I'm Heather Buckley.
And I'm Langley West.
And tonight for episode 78, we have a guest of Ed Kurtz, author and all-around swell guy.
You're too kind.
No, you're really. I love your work. I've never told you that, but I really do love your work.
You just now told me that.
I know.
Thank you.
Yeah. So tonight, Ed's here. I know you're a big fan of noir films.
I am.
And would you classify the work you do as noir?
Some of it, yeah. I mean, broadly speaking, I just say that I write about the people doing terrible things to each other. But yeah, I mean, some of it certainly is.
All right. But you are a big film fan and that.
Oh yeah.
All right, we're going to drag you into some deep water here.
Tom, for the folks who don't know, what has Ed written?
Your latest book is called Nausea?
True.
Or is that a review? And you have a new book coming out, right? The Rib From Which I Remake the World.
Also true, yes.
I love that title.
I wish I'd come up with it, but thank you.
It's okay.
We're going to say you did.
We're going to say...
that came entirely out of my own mind. Not at all Brett Savory from Cheesing Publications.
Are we going to have him read a paragraph of his work so the listeners at home know what kind of noir he writes?
That would have required preparation on my part.
Ed's like, what am I, a circus monkey?
Dance, monkey dance.
Yeah,
well, because I'm a huge fan of noir, but I'm a huge fan of like written noir, a certain style.
Yeah, you know, I could find a flash piece, but that's
even
up to y'all.
Even a sentence.
Well, let's
sentence.
We want to talk about one thing first, and then if you, as you can find something real quickly to appease these taskmasters.
I love noir so much, and I always think it's best when it's said out loud. And because I'm a big Jim Thompson fan, I'm hoping that he writes like hard boiled, nasty fucking bullets noir. Like there's just bullets on the page, and you got to read them. That's
I lived in Texas for 15 years, so I do write Southern noir.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I think, yeah.
I love Southern noir so much. And I've actually, the first piece of writing that I ever had published was noir.
Fantastic.
Yes. called Heist, about a spider and his gang and a gun heist and cops listening in and people getting shot in the face and sins of the father and all that sort of stuff.
An actual spider?
No, his name was Spider because okay. he came out of the joint. He has a spider tattooed on his hand. I based him off my friend Vic, who's a rockabilly boy.
So, what do we collectively think is the attraction to the subgenre? Ed, your guess. We'll get you your opinion first.
Well, you know, I as you well know, I'm a bit of a nihilist, and. I do think life is generally kind of suffering, and I think that that's largely due to the fact that human beings treat each other like garbage. And I think the vast preponderance of us understand what it's like to be treated like garbage, and quite a lot of us know what it's like to treat other people like garbage. And to me, that's kind of the essence of noir, is otherwise decent people in otherwise ordinary circumstances being thrown into situations where they're either forced to confront the nasty side of human nature, or forced to confront the nasty side of their own nature.
Mm-hmm. Well said. I was looking at online, and they quoted a book, the Panorama du Film Noir Américain, 1941-53. As you can see, I have a mastery of all languages, by Raymond Bord and Etienne Chalmeton. They said there were five attributes to noir. It has to be a word I don't know, I'll be honest with you. Oneiric. O-N-E-I-R-I-C. Never heard of it, so I'm going to take their word for that. I didn't look it up. It has to be strange. It has to be erotic. It has to be ambivalent. And it must be cruel.
It must what?
Be cruel.
Oh, yes. Well, I think life is generally erotic, ambivalent, and cruel.
Well, it's definitely a sucky deal to be given everything, and then to be in life in general, and then to have it slowly taken away blows. And when one's own avarice sort of orchestrates their own sort of demise, there's an inherent drama to that, correct?
Sure.
Am I going water wet? No.
Well, I think it depends on where you are, because he's talking about some sort of like a nihilist look on the world. Based on the noir that I guess I'm interested in, I'm right, is that I'm from the part of the world that is filled with, you know, honor, loyalties, crews, and criminals, because, you know, of my upbringing in Jersey City and what that means and what that environment means. So to me, it's like life is cruel. It's like, well, that's Jersey City. Jersey City's grim, but you have to hold your head down and do your job as a soldier. So
the characters that
I'm interested in have that sort of mentality.
I think it's so often, though, that a city, be it Jersey or Chicago or anywhere else, becomes not more than just stage from which a tale is told. It becomes a sort of a character in and of itself.
Sure.
And sometimes it's not even a specific city. Sometimes it's as generic as what was Will Eisner in The Spirit just called it, the city.
Right, right. And the interesting thing about noir is, although usually it's urban, it isn't necessarily so.
Is there country noir?
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah, Lansdale, right?
Yeah.
Does a lot of that.
I would argue that Night of the Hunter dips into what
absolutely,
yeah, what you might call it country noir.
Killer rednecks, hick noir.
I think that
that's supposed to be Jim Thompson.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the reason why people are drawn to noir is the same reason that kids, you know, burn ants with a magnifying glass
for fun.
Precisely. It's fun. It's fun to watch these people. I don't know what that says about us as fans of it, but it is. It's fun.
Nothing good.
In these horrible situations, because no matter what, thank God, I'm not that guy.
Well, there was a specific time that we think of when we think of a classic noir, right? That's like 40s through the 50s, right? Through World War II, the nihilism after World War II. Yes?
Particularly European nihilism. I mean, Americans were quite idealistic after World War II, but not so much in Europe.
One of the things that I read was saying that it stems from German expressionism, poetic realism, French New Wave later,
yes,
and the Italian neorealism.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So far,
so, yes.
Internet.
Yes.
Thank you, Wikipedia.
Film noir, I think, is a response to World War II in a lot
sure.
of different ways. In the American movies, a very concrete way that that was is that there's not a lot of money to go around, so you go and you make these. I think what was thought of at the time is kind of cheap throwaway movies.
Like the horror films.
Exactly, like the horror films, exactly. And not realizing that they were kind of creating this thing. And Ed's right, you know, Europe's different in their approach to it because their shit got all fucked up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were still walking around like, hey, we're aside from Pearl Harbor, we're unscathed.
Yeah, creating housing developments and the job market was great.
Yeah. It was good to sort of also for Middle America to sort of be a tourist in that seedy underworld.
Right.
I don't think it was all tourism, though. I mean, Langley talked about it being a little bit of schadenfreude to that, but I don't think that's entirely true. I think almost all human beings understand what it's like to have life just fuck you in the ass.
Sure.
And, you know, I think it's kind of easy to fall into that post-war myth that everybody was idealistic and doing well and the economy was great, but that's white upper middle class. That's
I was going to say, I think that's also, that's the mask that was, I mean, because even
Absolutely.
Like
yeah.
in the suburbs, you know, it looks like, you know, June Cleaver, but under the surface, there's...
I thought it's always interesting because everyone seems to have a secret and everyone seems to have a past.
Right.
And even the nice girl oftentimes has a past.
Right.
You know,
I've always said at the end of Leave It to Beaver, after the credits rolled and the screen went dark, June had Ward tied up in the cellar and
right?
was whipping
yeah.
the shit out of him.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there
was a real cleaver
sure.
somewhere.
There was something going on there that we didn't see, and that's always the case. And I think that too is kind of the nugget, the core of noir.
Yeah, agreed. And the idea that no one's life can stand that much scrutiny. I mean, you look
right.
deeply in anyone's life and you see beyond fractures in the
dude, I had 3 hours this morning of scrutiny. And you're right. No one is unscathed.
Were you subpoenaed?
I took a polygraph test this morning.
Fascinating.
For a job, yeah?
Yeah, for a job.
There
yeah.
we go. A real job. Like a,
yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
But yeah, the idea that, you know, again, you crack anyone's shell enough and you'll find some secret thing that is sort of, again, schadenfreude is a good word, Ed. That's absolutely
yeah.
perfect.
But it's, I mean, if life is crap and people are horrible in very boring ways. In noir, what you find is a cornucopia of fascinating, dramatic, interesting badness.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I go back to my Jersey City, because it's not the city itself. It's because, you know, my city is still filled with crime bosses, poor stuff, crazy politics that are opened up. It's actually a living landscape of a book going on right outside the doors since probably Mayor Haig was there. But again, when I find out people are shitty and horrible, it's not in some sort of fantastic way. And they don't have the right way that they're pulling you down or breaking your heart. The way they do in noir. It's very stylized, but it's also very poetic, like something like Shakespeare written tone poem. At least the stuff that I read is like that.
Do each of us have our own favorite?
Definitely.
Want to go around the table? Ed, you're the guest. Go first.
Killer Inside Me, Jim Thompson.
There we go.
Most fascinating character in popular literature to me is Lou Ford.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember. That's the Colin Hanks thing, yeah?
God, it wasn't Colin Hanks. It was Affleck. Casey Affleck.
Yeah, Casey Affleck. Right. Yeah.
And also, Stacey Keach did a version
yeah.
before that, of which I haven't seen.
I think it's a better version, personally.
Do you?
The other one has no teeth whatsoever.
No.
They have these prostitute girls, like, fucking him with full bra and, like, stuff on. It's not... not nasty, it's not mean, and the whole point is that he's a certain person on the outside, but on the inside, I mean, the title of the story is that he's a killer, he's smarter than you, he's fucked up, and there's no voiceover, and it's not really dramatized, and it's very strange. It's not sleazy enough.
Mm. Well, he's a psychopath, and he knows it, and he embraces it, and that's the thing I like about Southern noir. You were talking about Jersey City, but the thing about Southern noir, and I think Southern life, I'm from Arkansas. I've lived in the South all my life until the last 5 months. I'm in Minnesota now, for Christ's sakes. But is that Southern life is really about masks. It's mm-hmm. really about appearances. And absolutely none of us are fooled by it.
Right.
We all know what the real deal is, but everybody has to put on appearances, and that's what Lou Ford does in The Killer Inside Me. He has an appearance, he has a mask, he has a character that he plays, and in a sense, everybody in Southern society does that. But he's that writ large and writ evil because he's such a psychopath, and he has no conscience whatsoever.
Yeah. Yeah, I know in the remake, I guess, we get to see, it gets a little, I'm surprised you're saying it doesn't have teeth, because there's a, like, isn't it Jennifer Lopez who gets beat up in that movie? Pretty graphic?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hmm. Interesting. I haven't seen the original, I need to check that out. Heather?
Well, since Killer Inside is my favorite, I'm going to go with something that I feel very inspirational. About
your
in my life. No, baby. You can totally have it. Is The Dark Half. Is that Stephen King plus a noir writer, and I myself am very obsessed with the character of George Stark, which is why I own a 67 Buick Riviera, because it's the closest to the Toronado I could get.
Yeah,
and
I
like to carry a straight razor with me and wear all black, and I write noir and drink whiskey. So I love it. And I tell people I'm a high-toned son of a bitch, and I call people Hoss. So that.
Sure.
I
didn't know you Yankees did that.
I want to believe that I'm from Mississippi. When I was in Mississippi, I drove through going to Florida. I wrote in the book that I said it's like George Stark. It's like, why are you driving through? It's like writing a novel.
That's funny.
Yes. Yeah, sparrows are flying, Thad.
Wiley?
I don't know. It's kind of a toss-up. If I'm going older school, and a lot of people would argue that this isn't a film noir, but I think it is. They would argue that neither of these are, but I think they are. And that is Sunset Boulevard.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. I was going to mention that. Yeah. I love that film.
Yeah, it's a great film. Gloria Swanson is like one of the most frightening.
It was a perfect capture. They captured her at the perfect time in her career for that. To do that role.
Absolutely. And if I was looking at modern day, I got to go with Old Boy.
Nice.
Yeah, well, a lot of people would, you know, say, well, that's not film noir. You know, where's your,
sure it is.
You know, where's your gumshoe? Where, you know, but
it's
that's
there.
That's missing.
It's there.
It's missing the point.
You
of
could argue it all the way down the line.
Well, yeah, because, you know, one of the things that, you know, we were talking about is, you know, these secrets and these things and people being put in these really shitty circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
And, we have this anti-hero. He's, you know, with the tag hero only through, because he's the guy that
he's
we're
the focus.
Following.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
I would argue that, you know, the anti-hero probably, you know, came about. In the gangster film, which came a little bit earlier,
mm-hmm.
but I think he developed and completely matured in the film noir.
Okay, I'm gonna go. You guys are stealing my entire list. I'm gonna go with the Latchkey was Out of the Past.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I just love that movie. Yeah. And I also throw up there, we can't talk, I just make sure, because I so want to bring this up, is Richard Widmark in Kiss of Death.
Yeah.
Boyfriend.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's so.
That grinning, maniacal, yeah.
Yeah, talk about the, when they say breakout role.
Yeah.
Like, absolutely.
So Widmark did that well late into his career. Did you ever see Foul Play with Goldie Hawn and Chevy Chase?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was an old man by then. He was doing the same thing, and he was terrific.
I love Whitmark's performance because he's playing a cat, but I believe the Dane in Miller's Crossing is playing a version of his character, but it's almost like a panther.
That's interesting.
Yes. Yeah, wow, yeah. Great observation.
Miller's Crossing is another good one.
It is.
It gets brought up every now and again in conversation, and everyone nods.
Yeah, I have
The other thing I wanted to mention was I guess it could be considered a shitty situation, but in my notes today I came across Panic in the Streets.
Yeah.
Which is not really a person doing anything that to put himself there.
Right.
This is just a reaction to a potential epidemic.
Right.
In a highly populated area. And it's great.
Mm-hmm.
And again, Richard Widmark, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, and I think it had some, gosh, I can't remember now. Did it have a really young Nimoy in it? No,
Jack Palance, right?
Jack Palance, yeah. Because, you know, Jack Palance and Leonard Nimoy are the same person.
Sure.
Clearly.
Say again, Ed?
I said clearly.
Yeah.
Well, hell, if you're going to talk about epidemics, I mean, even Miracle Mile has terrific noir elements.
Oh, absolutely.
Anthony Edwards, yeah.
Yeah, that's another good one that slips by, you know, it gets brought up every now and again.
This is the type of, you know, these are the types of films that people who are fans all know and check out, but they're the types of films that get, you know, largely forgotten by the I don't know, the general populace, it seems like. Like, I'll talk to somebody about, you know, Kiss Me Deadly.
Mm-hmm.
And they know the phrase, but they don't. Nobody's really that I talk to has watched the movie or know
that's where
the glowing suitcase came from in Pulp Fiction, et cetera, et cetera.
Great.
Well, I hope the people playing it at home are keeping a list.
Yeah, I would think that people would do that. I tend to do that just so because I see so much that it's like I gotta keep track because there's nothing worse for me because I'm so wrapped so fucking tight that to get halfway through a movie and go, oh fuck, I've seen this. But even then, I mean, it can be argued that it's another template that can be applied to virtually any culture, any time. In many ways, I would there are noir elements to even those like the Zatoichi movies.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
it's not like saying a monster movie where you have to have a monster in order for it to be a monster movie. Like, there's so many things that can be noir. We were talking about it earlier. It's like how broad it is. I mean, we. You know, a lot of people have this narrow definition, you know, of those films that were made, you know, from 40 to 50 or, you know, in that area. And it's really, it just so happened that that's when a lot of those were being made.
Mm-hmm.
But it's so much broader than that. It's one of those things, I would argue that a lot of times film noir is something that you may not be able to say exactly what it is, but you know it when you see it.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. And again, it could even be there's this whole future sci-fi noir, you know, Blade Runner being a fine example.
Sure.
Dark City being another one.
Yeah.
Heather up, yeah.
She's like, no.
No.
Dark City,
yes.
I'm a huge fan of Dark City, and that definitely has a lot of noir elements. It's noir-esque, but it's of course a combination of a whole bunch of different other things. It's why I love it. I mean, if you combine, I'm not a big fan of sci-fi, and people always want to challenge me on that, but if you combine sci-fi with horror, specifically with monsters, and sci-fi with noir, or if you combine anything on Earth with noir or westerns, it just becomes the best thing in the world. Like horror plus western, horror plus noir, like Cast a Deadly Spell, I just become horribly obsessed. Because I like a lot of artifice and a lot of masculine iconography and posing in my films. Because it influences me as a lady. Actually, it does. So I feel very inspired by the sort of images of power and how they talk and how they move.
So how much does film inform your work? And I know mine, it's all over, that in music, it's all over the place. But how does it inform your stuff?
Ed.
A lot, to the point where I feel like maybe I need to cool out and not write about film so much.
Do you think in film? Like, do you think in imagery, or do you think in, like, construct? And
I definitely do, and, you know, two of my books are revolved almost entirely around cinema. The 42, which is my love letter to the New York grindhouse scene in the 70s, and Angel of the Abyss, which is about a very noir novel about a lost silent film that is discovered in the 21st century that may very well be a snuff film.
Wow.
Very cool.
I love the premise.
I mean, I'm so obsessed with cinema that it's very difficult for me not to think in those terms.
Yeah, I agree. I tend to see the movie in my head, and then this gets a little strange. But the idea of being able to stop the film and stop in the scene and look around, and that's how you get your detail. But I have to see it first. If I don't see it, then it's gone. Forget it. It just doesn't work. I have a list here that Ed Mutter did online of top 25. Mm-hmm. And I thought that we could just kind of go down it and just talk about it. Does that sound like fun?
Absolutely not.
All right. So we'll rip that up. And most of these we've sort of talked about, but I just want to make sure that we hit some of these as well, because when I was making the list, it was pretty I was like, oh, yeah. The first one they list is Raw Deal from 1948. It's okay to say pass.
Remade as a Schwarzenegger film, if I'm not mistaken.
Was it really?
I believe so, yes.
I like it. That's featuring the famous line, "You should not drink and bake."
I disagree with that sentiment.
Aren't there whole shows about drinking and cooking now?
Are there really?
The drunk...
Oh, yeah, YouTube or whatever?
Yeah.
Then they list The City That Never Sleeps, 1952. A lot of silence here, maybe, kids.
I like...
Okay, that. Touch of Evil.
Yeah, okay, Touch of Evil.
Unquestionably.
Fan.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Oh, it's brilliant, and it does a weird thing, because so much of film noir was so highly stylized, and it combined cinema verite, you know, the kind of French New Wave stuff,
mm-hmm.
as far as the filmmaking goes, with this stylized thing, because, you know, the French stuff was, you know, based on, like, documentary type shooting, and it's all real, and it does this weird balancing act between the two. And for people who haven't seen it, I mean, Charlton Heston as a Mexican, you know.
I think it's a better Citizen Kane. What do you say? I get a lot of shit about that.
I'm not going to give you shit, but I disagree. But I think it's really, really, really good.
I think it's Welles' best film.
Yeah.
So there you go. Scarlet Street, 1945.
Edward G. Robinson.
How great is Edward G. Robinson? I was just looking at some scenes from Key Largo the other day.
Yeah.
In preparation for this. I was in on a podcast once, and the guy was arguing that it's a home invasion film, and I agreed.
I wouldn't have thought of it that way until you say that, but then, yeah.
Right?
Not in the same sense of The Desperate Hours, perhaps, but yeah, I could see that.
Yeah. Detour, 1945.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Maybe
tell me why.
The greatest B picture ever made.
There we go. 1951, Tomorrow is Another Day. I'm going to pass on that one.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
1950, The Prowler. Some of these are...
These are not the titles that I...
Okay. Gun Crazy, 1950.
Yes.
Yeah. Gun Crazy, yeah.
It's terrific.
Great evil blonde femme fatale in that one.
You know, I was reading a theory that the whole reason that the femme fatale kind of developed in these types of movies was to have her assume power, you know, of some type, only to put her in her place at the
really?
End of the movie. Yeah.
Yeah, because ultimately, what's the line? I never met a Dane that didn't understand a slap in the mouth
right.
or a slug from a...
Ooh, boy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That brings us into angrier. That brings us into a whole discussion about misogyny and noir.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, that's a huge, yeah.
Well, it was male fantasy for the most part, where, you know, women were objects and...
But that's today's society still.
In many ways.
Probably not as bad as, say, 1950, but yeah, definitely.
Uh-huh.
But
I think you specifically don't want to say male fantasy, but that's sort of like a certain man's sort of like pulp fantasy. That's kind of like a blue-collar...
Oh, very much,
...fantasy that they were having. It was not like the 50 Shades of Grey submissive lovely and it's not the erudite 120 Days in Sodom. It's like, let me fuck you in the alley there.
I think you know, you're talking about pulp, you know, fantasy. I mean, so much of this came out of that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this stuff existed prior to these films being made in the form of, you know, those little yellow
absolutely
books. Yeah,
the pulp books and what have you.
True detective type stuff and I think that was always the market for that, and the reason why they got made into film is because they needed a cheap...
Absolutely. You know, there was quick stories. There was lots of them.
Yeah.
Sure.
Well, what's great about noir women is that a lot of them, if you see, like, you know, that's sort of like misogyny today, those women fucking had guns and hit back.
Yeah. There was a secret power there, I agree. I've traced before noir as being one of the seeds that ultimately ended up producing, I think we've talked about it on the show, ultimately produced the Italian giallo. Right.
Sure.
I was just about to say that.
Yeah, it's absolutely. I think you take it through the German crimi films, and you take it through giallo, and it take you right on through to the American slasher film.
Yes.
So, I mean, even horror fans need to be up on some of this shit.
Yeah.
Motherfuckers.
And by way of Edgar Wallace, too.
Absolutely.
Huge in Germany and then Italy.
Yeah, Edgar Wallace was a guy who pretty much just blew his nose on a piece of paper, and it was made into some kind of movie.
Oh yeah, he was he outsold the Bible in Britain for a long time.
Mm-hmm. And I've seen a lot of those. What was it, the Beast of Blackmoor Castle or?
Yeah, there were a bunch of those German creamy films, that, and like half of them had Klaus Kinski in them.
Yeah, yeah, Klaus just being unchained as well.
Oh, great stuff. Well, when wasn't it? Yeah.
There's a man who had no choice. He had to be in film.
Him and Michael J. Pollard.
Yeah, right.
And Michael Berryman. It's like, dude, what else are you going to do? You ain't selling shoes, motherfucker. All right. 1959, Odds Against Tomorrow.
No.
Moving on. 1956, here's a good one, The Killing.
I was going to mention one of my favorite noir female characters. I think no one read a line like Marie Windsor.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Elijah Cook Jr. is his wife in that
Elijah
film.
Elijah Cook, once again, movie helper.
Yeah.
Just add him to anything,
and
he's going to be good. Sterling Hayden not being Sterling Hayden. I mean, kind of being Sterling Hayden. But
Sterling Hayden enough for my needs.
Yeah, not unchained. I'm trying to remember.
But Timothy Clary, I mean, he's the one you got to watch in that film.
Yeah. This is the boxing movie, correct?
The Killing with Kubrick, 1956?
Yeah.
No, it's about the horse.
What's the boxing movie?
Oh.
That Sterling Hayden was in. Hold, please. Keep talking.
Talk amongst ourselves. So, Langley, how's your day been?
moving on. I'll come back to Sterling Hayden. They Live by Night, 1949.
Yeah.
Yeah, is that a recognition or?
Yeah, recognition. I don't think that's the boxing movie. I know what.
No,
you're
I'll find
about.
It. No, that's something else. I'm moving on. 1949, Thieves Highway. We're coming. We're kind of goose eggs. 1949, 1958, Sweet Smell of Success.
How about Lady in the Lake, 1947?
I've not seen that.
It's really interesting. It's a gimmicky film.
That's Chandler, yes.
Yeah, Chandler, but it's all filmed first person.
Right, right.
So, like this new crazy thing, Hardcore Henry. It's like that. Everything is from his POV, with it, minus the shaky cam, and you get like glimpses of him in a mirror, that kind of stuff. And I think that's the only notable thing about it. But it's notable to pay attention to these types of things, because there are things in these movies every now and then that are really innovative, and people don't think about them because they are such kind of cheaply made, toss-away thrillers. Kiss Me Deadly is a nuts movie. It's just nuts. And that idea of the briefcase, but you don't know what's in it, and it's got this light coming out of it. You're like, what the hell? Can you imagine the people? You know, like I can't imagine it was received. Well, I don't know.
Lots of scratching of heads.
Yeah.
It blew my mind when I saw it.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
It's a great movie.
It's great. It is on here. The movie, I'm going to go through the rest of this real quick. The Killers, Moonrise, we already mentioned Out of the Past. Night in the City, great.
Mm.
Yeah.
Absolutely terrific. Nightmare Alley, Maltese Falcon, everyone knows.
Naturally.
That everyone knows. That Casablanca, everyone knows that. Double Indemnity.
Yeah.
No. James Caine. Yeah.
I had heard about Double Indemnity for years growing up. My mom talked about it and all that stuff. And when I finally saw it, I was kind of let down.
Well, because it had been built up for you. I mean, it's 1944. We've got Barbara Stanwyck
looking great,
looking amazing,
always
convincing Fred McMurray to kill her husband. Mm-hmm. It's pretty badass.
That was the one other thing about Noir. Noir was like a second chance for people like Fred McMurray,
right.
Dick Powell. They'd already sort of exhausted the funny, like comedies and dancing and Leading Men and that kind of stuff, and now they could still carry a picture, but it was one of these lower.
Right.
But can we forgive Dick Powell for The Conqueror? I think not.
No, one can be forgiven for The Conqueror.
And then, oddly, the last two they mentioned were Criss Cross, which I'd never heard of, and another one I'd never heard of, and I thought I had seen all the Bogart movies, In a Lonely Place. So there.
I
vaguely remember, though, and I'm surprised Strangers on a Train is not on that list.
Agreed, right?
Yeah.
Or The Asphalt Jungle.
I was going to say, that's a weird list, because there's, I mean, he didn't mention DOA.
Didn't mention DOA.
Which is...
Yeah. Ed Mutter, you're a dick.
Yeah. Get your shit together.
You son of a bitch.
We're gonna run into him one day at a con or something, and he's going to go, hey, motherfucker.
And we're not going to know who the hell...
I'm used to that response. Y'all are on your own.
We were talking about Touch of Evil. What about Lady from Shanghai?
Another great Wells, yeah.
Yeah, another great one.
Yeah. Not directed by Wells, but...
Rita Hayworth. Everyone always mentions...
Wait, was that...
Yeah, directed by Wells. Everyone always mentions Gilda, but... Just as hot in this one.
Laura.
Yeah, terrific. Yeah.
Laura's amazing, and I think a really good example of... if you're gonna say, you know... If somebody comes to you and says, I don't know what a film noir is, you know, Laura's a good example to show them.
Great theme song, too.
Yeah. Good pull.
I got to go back to Night of the Hunter.
Okay.
Because Night of the Hunter is notable for a few things.
Pot-smoking Robert Mitchum.
Yeah, pot-smoking Robert Mitchum with his hate and love tattooed on his...
I'm always writing that on my knuckle.
Are you?
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I do it in his sort of like prison style, but also like in Mike Ness' Social Distortion style. It's very nice.
For me, it's always Aussie rules, but hey. that's rules with a Z, of course.
Like right. Jersey with a Z.
With a kit or a kiss ass.
I think it's the only film that was directed by Charles Laughton. Is that correct?
Yeah,
I think you're right.
The only film he directed, and then did so badly at the box office, he never directed it again. It came to be an incredible, incredible masterpiece.
The one and only William Bly in my book.
Oh, yeah. If nothing else about that movie was good, I watched it for that scene
with the kids.
Her on the front porch, the screened-in porch with the shotgun on her lap, and he's out there, and then he's not. And it's somebody was calling this movie a film noir. It's because it's a horror film, and it's a
horror
film. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It says here Charles Lawton also directed, was uncredited on a film called The Man on the Eiffel Tower from 1949.
Oh, fuck you, Internet.
Once again, this show is sponsored by Wikipedia and alcohol. Yeah.
Don't harsh my buzz, Internet.
Say again?
Don't harsh my buzz, Internet.
Right. I know, right? I think it was, they try once in a while. Wasn't Shane Black's Kiss Kiss Bang Bang essentially trying to, one of those things, LA Confidential kind of tried to bring
LA
it back?
LA Confidential, I would argue, is I think there's a difference between movies that are inherently noir, and then there's movies that are intentionally trying to be noir. And they can be great. I think L.A. Confidential is a great film. I would even say that of Touch of Evil, though. I think that by the time Touch of Evil came around, which was what, 1958? Something like that?
Sure.
That film noir was self-aware and that there was tropes in place.
Well, we've gotten to a point now where any guy that shows up in an overcoat and a hat...
Sure.
We immediately go, okay, we know what this is.
Well, and there's
some... You mean Ben Grimm in disguise?
Ben Grimm in disguise. Did we talk about Murder by Sweet, My Sweet?
Yeah. I like Murder by Death.
Peter Falk, all right.
Say again?
I said Peter Falk, all right.
Yeah, you know, the thing about Murder by... I don't think of it as a noir so much as like a drawing room murder mystery.
I think of it as something I watched on TBS a lot growing up.
that movie is so smart and so sort of informed that it's amazing that it was made by a major studio.
One of my favorite, latter day... noirs or neo-noir, whatever you want to call it, is Bound by the Wachowski brothers.
Terrific example, yeah.
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 I mean, it's got all the elements there, and you've got this, what's cool about it is the misogyny is there, and it gets dealt back. And it's
almost exposed in...
Yeah,
well, it's turned on its head, absolutely.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah, it's great. And
well, look at something like 9 1/2 weeks, same sort of thing.
Sure.
You go in and you think you're getting one thing, and then it all spins on its head.
Yeah. And besides, those ladies are gorgeous, and I'll watch that movie all the time.
And here we are.
Here's the misogyny.
Well, I want you to know from a female's perspective is that I watch all the noir for the hot guys in suits carrying gay.
See? And I don't think there's anything wrong
with
that.
You guys are all based in
pure. I don't think there's anything
wrong. We are.
With recognizing your baser animalistic self. I'm ruled by my reptilian brain, Tom.
How can you sound like a smart-dressed hitman? Come on. Or like, watch Killer Joe and grab your pearls, because it's like, good lord.
Killer Joe.
Fried chicken, anyone?
Yeah, I know. We actually thought, I've heard this is good, and we throw it on, and just so happens my wife's mother was here. Nana was here.
Oh, no.
And all of a sudden, we're sitting there kind of, it's going south, and there's a lot, I'm kind of chuckling nervously, like, what do you think, huh? Awful. Absolutely awful. Can we talk about the French New Wave? We talked a little bit about it, but people like...
Like Cassavetes, killing of a Chinese bookie?
Sure.
I was thinking start right there.
Like Melville and
Clouzet and those kind of guys.
Even Godard. I mean, Alphaville is like a terrific sci-fi, like zero-budget sci-fi noir.
Well, and I would contend that Alphaville is one of the first sci-fi noirs. Did you just say that?
Yes.
Okay.
I did say that.
That's bizarre. Because as you were saying that, I was like, I have a great idea. All right. Not impaired in the least. One of the names that came up that surprised me, I'm going to come back to the Princeton Wave. I'm just looking at those. Minority Report. That kind of gave me a weird gong sound.
I'm automatically prejudiced against anything Spielberg does.
Shakespeare, Spielberg, same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, same thing.
Yeah.
I'm pro Spielberg over here in my world, but I love adorable pop things as much as I love Serbian film.
Well, I've already outed myself as being this sort of closeted Tom Cruise fan.
Right.
So
he's great in Tropic Thunder and Legend.
What's that, Ed?
I said, I'm hanging up.
Yeah, I know. No, I do.
I'm out.
It just so happens that if you hand me a list of Tom Cruise films and tell me which ones did you like and which ones did you hate, there's going to be a lot more likes for some reason. I don't know what it is. I just like a lot of what he's choosing, even when it's flawed. So yeah. Fuck all you guys. I had just seen, speaking of the French, going back to the French Wave, Melville's Bob Le Flambeur recently.
Oh, my goodness, yes.
So good, man. And looks like it was just shot out of someone's briefcase, but super well orchestrated guy. Have you ever seen it?
No.
Guy, they're planning to rob a casino, and he's like the big sort of mover and shaker dude.
Sure.
Fucking awesome. All right. Come on, guys. Louis Malle is another one. Elevator to the Gallows.
Terrific picture.
Great picture, yeah. Yeah.
Great title.
Yeah, it's great. At first, I used to get that confused with the other one, with Lady in a Cage.
Remember? Similar, yeah. With the guy, was that Olivia de Havilland?
Yeah, Olivia de Havilland. James Caan, I think, is the main thug.
Interesting, a lot of the directors who were making the American film noir films, you know, were all cats that came from Europe. Not all of them, but a lot of them were.
Well, Fritz Lang.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Fritz Lang. Yeah. Robert, what's his name?
Siedmak.
Siedmak, yeah.
Did The Killers. Michael Curtis.
Yeah, a lot of
the guys. I love that. Michael Curtis did, not only did he do Casablanca, but he also did White Christmas.
And Yankee Doodle Dandy.
Yeah, and the Yankee Doodle Dandy.
Yeah.
I love White Christmas. So there.
And all the cats that we think of as like great directors, at least from that
they've
time.
They've dabbled.
They've all done these. John Huston.
John Huston, Akira Kurosawa.
Akira Kurosawa.
He did Stray Dog, High and Low, and The Bad Sleep Well. And they all are straight up noirs.
Yeah.
Stray Dog, it doesn't get any more noir than that.
Yeah.
And High and Low was a Ed McBain novel.
Yeah.
Adaptation. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
See, I know my shit.
Yeah, you do know your shit. I'm looking over these other names that they threw out. Joseph von Sternberg did the Blue Angel, dabbled in it.
Right.
Luchino Visconti who did Days of Glory had one.
Otto Preminger.
Yeah,
everybody had their.
So why isn't it being done more today?
Well, I think it is. Well,
why?
Wait, today or like in the last 30 years?
Well, in the last 10 years.
In the last 10 years.
Other than like The Killer Inside Me came out.
Because there's no comic book characters. There's nobody running around in their underwear in a cage.
Everybody goes to Brick.
Yeah.
Brick is amazing.
Is it? I've never seen it.
Holy shit, man.
I saw it in the theater with the director there. It was wonderful. It was when I was watching noir films per decade anthology.
There seemed to be a resurgence of these types of films in the 90s, in my opinion. Memento. Definitely a noir film. You know, it's a guy in this weird situation, like kind of like EOA, except that he's not dying. this isn't the 90s, but Blue Velvet is
yep.
heavy metal.
That movie I could watch every day.
Pulp Fiction.
Really?
Reservoir Dogs.
You guys are killing me.
Dude, I love
Reservoir Dogs, sure. I think a lot of the early Tarantino stuff was informed.
Yeah, absolutely. Devil in a Blue Dress with Denzel Washington.
Yes. That was an overlooked film.
Yeah, it's a great film. Yeah, absolutely. Angel Heart. Drips.
Yeah, I forgot about Angel Heart.
You know, Tarantino's very influenced by 70s and 80s HK cinema as well. You get something like A Better Tomorrow.
Yeah. I have that in my notes here about, yeah, absolutely. That was a whole cottage industry, all the gentleman gangster movies.
Right,
yeah.
From Hong Kong. And
the killer hard-boiled.
Yeah.
And we've both showed
Cheyenne Fats in all of them. But, yeah.
Yeah, and then it bled over into the Japanese Yakuza film. So, absolutely.
It's interesting. It's fun. It's a fun exercise to see how all this stuff interconnects, you know, because you think of, you know, gangster films as gangster films. You think of noir films as it's people wind up creating a stereotype for a particular genre when really the genre is much more than that. But mm-hmm. like, you know, like you said, we think of the film noir as the guy in the trench coat, you know, in the office, the dame walks in his door.
Here's an odd one that I just thought of. The Detective D movies, the Troy Ooh. Hark Detective D.
Oh, yeah.
They don't fit into our little box very well, but...
No, they're kind of wooksy fantasy pictures, but yeah, they're absolutely noirish.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks for validating me.
That's what I'm here for. My check's in the mail, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. All right.
What do we think about parodies or satires or...
I love Johnny Dangerously.
John.
Is that what you asked me, finally? I got my dog in my hand.
Say it, Ed, say it.
Dead men don't wear blood.
Absolutely.
It's great.
Yeah.
It's great. I mean, it's recognizing those things that we love about these films and just running with it. Garrison Keillor. Garrison Keillor.
Like Wolbegaard?
If you listen to the parodies, there's a continuing character called Guy Noir.
Guy Noir?
Yeah.
I may live in Minnesota, but I'm unfamiliar with Keillor's work.
Yeah, you may have to.
Dude,
you may have to check
that guy is just too homespun for me.
They might kick me out.
And without Noir, we wouldn't have, I don't know why I'm thinking of this, but the trope of the gumshoe in porn, right?
Oh, sure.
That's the great setup. I'm here to interview you for this crime and bam.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Come on in.
There you go.
Yeah.
A really great one is, I can't remember the director, but Punk Rock in the late 70s. I don't know if you've seen that picture.
It's called Punk Rock?
It's called Punk Rock. And
Oddly enough, I haven't seen it.
I was going to say, Heather.
it's a really terrific, just old school grindhouse noir porn.
Wow!
We will have to.
It kind of also
not that I would know anything about that sort of thing.
Yeah. And then you start to see elements of this in like some Japanese horror, the schoolgirl, the haunted high school
sure.
movies. Same thing with the playing with the lighting, playing with a lot of the archetypes.
I think that that's what a lot of people came away from these movies with was the stylization,
mm-hmm.
the high contrast lighting.
Well, it's use of shadow and light.
Right.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you were talking about Eisner earlier. I mean, his stuff is, I'd have to look and see which came first because mm-hmm. his stuff is so of this.
Yeah.
You know,
I think the films came first, and like Eisner started like in the early 60s.
Yeah, like the spirit.
Yeah, you know,
as goofy as it was, sometimes mm-hmm. It looks like it comes from this world.
Yeah,
which is
a
why
lot of
Frank
the
Miller stuff looks like that.
The Sin City
why
stuff.
Sin City. Yeah,
and Darwin Cook, rest in peace.
Yes.
And his Stark stuff. If we want to talk about that as well.
Talk about what?
The Richard Stark stuff. that Darwin Cook was adapting the Richard Stark novels, The Hunter, and I mean, which are really terrific.
That's who George Stark's name came from, that in Starkweather.
Really? Oh, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Look at you guys.
I mean, that was Donald Westlake, but, you know, he normally wrote fairly lighthearted stuff, so his nom de plume for the darker stuff was Richard Stark, and those novels are really fantastic, and Darwin Cook was adapting them all for graphic novels, and they're really, really good.
Kind of a sidebar, are you a Don Hamilton fan?
I'm not very familiar with Hamilton.
He did the Matt Helm books?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. They started re-releasing those a few years ago on paperback. I stopped reading them, and I'll tell you why. I don't remember the title, but the third Matt Helm novel, there was the scene that... and, you know, I try to take these things in stride in terms of their era and what have you, but there was a scene where Matt Helm literally lets his wife... He doesn't prevent this. He lets his wife get raped by the bad
guy. Yes, 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 yes.
Tom's so excited because I got him that book.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it will help his mission, you know? And I was so deeply offended by this.
Agreed.
That I couldn't finish reading the book, and I never touched Helm again.
That is exactly where I set it down. Yep. I said to my wife, you will not believe what just happened in this book.
It was so bad. And I'm thinking, you know, I've seen the Dean Martin films, and they're not like this at all.
No. And I used the word I love lightly, but I love the way afterward he's kind of not quite annoyed, but like make yourself presentable.
Yeah, it's awful.
Like, it really is. The only other thing that ever... offended me like that was Verotic Comics did a story that Hart Fisher wrote that got under my had something to do with a woman who was gang raped, and at the end the tape of it is delivered to her father, who sits and masturbates to it, and it was
holy shit. Geez.
yeah it was off the chain. It's something about the word cherry is in the title.
Mm.
But it's really severe and really hard to take, and like this thing in the Matt Helm thing, I was just like, holy shit.
Yeah, I was enjoying the hell out of the whole period and the proceedings with Helm. Read the first two books, enjoyed them, and then when I get to that scene on the third one, I thought, oh my god, this is too much. But what you just said actually reminded me of a terrific film that I believe Paul Schrader directed, Hardcore with George C. Scott.
Oh,
that
sure,
is a great movie.
Can your response be no, no?
that's very noir, and he's certainly not masturbating when he watches that.
No,
yeah.
No,
yeah.
Unless that's a deleted scene that I'm not aware of.
That would be in the bonus material.
That, yeah, yeah. that totally changes that whole movie.
Oh, that's awful. That's terrible. I'm sad now.
Yeah. There was like a whole lot of it masquerading. It sort of mutated through the 70s into the 70s cop movies.
Right.
They were essentially dealing on the same playground.
Yeah, stuff like the 7-Ups.
Yeah, Fuzz. Yeah. All that stuff. It was different, but it's
French Connection, sure.
French Connection is better example.
That was the one that was just sitting there.
God, Chinatown.
Yeah, Chinatown.
You know,
I think you could make an argument that that's the pinnacle of the genre, really.
Agreed.
Yeah.
One of them.
Yeah.
At least, especially of the modern day. Absolutely.
And that was Robert Towne who wrote that script, if I'm not mistaken. It's just absolutely just pitch perfect screenplay.
Yeah,
it's so good.
It's one of the screenplays that's always cited as, like, if you want to look at a perfect screenplay or as close to perfect as you can, Chinatown.
This is the one.
Yeah.
All right, we're coming up on our hour, so
I'm gonna bring up what I think is an overlooked nihilistic classic.
You got my attention.
Okay. Who Framed Roger Rabbit?
Yes.
Wow, yeah. Wow.
Okay, so
talk about
I'm joking, but this is definitely taking all those things that we take from those films and, you know, Disneyfies it, or, you know, or whoever did that.
Well, that's kind of using Disney against itself, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And, and
because all the archetypes are there.
Right, exactly.
You know?
And I think it's brilliant. It's not brilliant like, you know, I don't know. The Big Sleep is brilliant. But it definitely, I think it's mentioned in the show. Who framed Roger Rabbit?
Yeah. That would, yeah, good pull. I'm looking over my list to see if there's anything I forgot. Anybody have a title that we're missing out on?
No Country for Old Men.
No. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
He's actually hang out like in that area of the world, not necessarily neo-noir, but the sort of hard-boiled, stark Americana stuff.
Right. You know, I would argue that, like, when the Coen brothers aren't doing comedy, almost all of their stuff fits in this category.
Blood Simple. What was the one with Billy Bob Thornton? The
Simple Plan?
No.
No.
That's
Ring Blade?
Yeah, that's right.
The Man Who Wasn't There.
Oh, yes.
Something like that, yeah. Yeah, I agree, yeah.
I don't know if it's...
Didn't they do Miller's Crossing?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
And for that matter, if you... a lot of... I wouldn't consider... No Country for Old Men a Western, but it just kind of reminded me. There's a lot of Western noir out there as well.
I'm sure.
Particularly of Anthony Mann's films, and in particular, The Naked Spur.
Yeah.
That's a.
Yeah, I think you're alone on that one.
Have you I'm seen alone it? On that one?
No, I haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it, but...
Oh, yeah.
I know the title, but I can't remember. I don't know if I've seen it.
Discussion of noir Western could be interesting because I've never thought.
It's James Stewart and Janet Leigh, and I've been spending the last 20 years of my life trying to convince anybody that thinks otherwise that James Stewart is one of the greatest treasures we've had in cinema performance.
Absolutely.
For people that have only ever seen It's a Wonderful Life and Harvey.
Yeah.
And they always misunderstand Harvey because it's not a happy story. But
right. His Westerns were great. Man Shall Live with Balance.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Naked Spur, I think, is one of his two best performances, that and Vertigo, which also has its noir qualities.
You know what's a really good noir that we haven't mentioned is Pick Up on South Street.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Samuel Fuller.
Really?
Yeah.
His name was listed, and I thought that must have been...
Probably mostly for that movie. It's a straight-up... Is it Richard Widmark again? I think so.
Mm.
But it also crosses into Cold War.
Yeah.
Story. Because what happens is he's a pickpocket, and he picks this lady's purse, and he winds up getting a document that's wanted by spies, or remember now, but the ball just starts unraveling, and everything starts getting, you know. That's a great movie. And Samuel Fuller is one of those guys that he made, you know, war films and a lot of, but the a Shock Corridor, and they all
mm-hmm. have
this kind of noir
absolutely
feel to them. I mean, there's this darkness. There's
you want to talk about nihilism.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Oh, God, yeah.
I mean, even go to the end of this curve, White Dog. Have you seen that picture?
Fuck yeah, White Dog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
That's a deeply nihilistic picture.
Yeah. I think that is...
Nobody wins in that film.
No.
You know what we should actually talk about? True Detective, then, if we want to talk about nihilism and influence of Ligotti on that work, because he's taking stuff from Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, Kierkegaard into his work.
Yeah, you're talking my language now.
Anytime you want, baby.
Life is meaningless, folks.
It is. Well, I always think the idea of the evolutionary nihilism is that consciousness is our biggest curse. That's why I tell people that I wish that we were frogs, because I think it was much easier just to live our life in a pond, live by the forces of nature and disappear, other than our reflective quality, which some don't have, but for others are the tortures of hell.
You and I need to chat.
Yeah, I knew you guys would get along just fine.
I like the cut of your jib.
I wear spurs on my steel cap engineer boots.
There you go.
That just made me want to drink.
So there we go.
Yeah, I think I'll have another rum and coke while we're at it.
What about Seven?
Definitely.
Sure. Yes.
I'm not a huge Fincher fan, I have to admit. He rubs me a little bit the wrong way. But of all the Fincher films I've seen, if he has a masterpiece, that's it.
Yeah. Here's an interesting one, speaking to Fincher. In my wanderings today, I read an argument that, speaking to Fincher, that Alien 3 was based on a movie called Brute Force with Burt Lancaster and Hume Cronin.
Wow.
Right? It's like guys in prison.
What?
Yeah.
You just blew my mind.
Thanks. No, yeah.
And I've been waiting all night to get blown, so thanks.
I think it's easy to go after the fact and find.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I don't know that this was something that Fincher ever said, but the guy was arguing like structurally they're very similar.
Well, you know, the first Alien was largely based on Bava's Planet of the Vampires and another picture called It, the Terror from Beyond Space.
Sure, yeah.
So, I mean, it would fit with the
and it's essentially
with the tradition.
The first one is Alien, and we talked about this on our Alien episode, but is essentially a haunted house movie.
Yes.
Right.
And it's like a big dark house or haunted house, whatever you want to call it.
Right.
Yeah. So in the end, what can we do to, you know what I mean? Like I mean, Ed, you're doing your stuff, and that's.
I've already said I'm a nihilist, so the answer is nothing.
Nothing.
We can do nothing.
I would say that Clown Town is. Is a
way to go.
Is a noir.
Yeah. I was going to mention that at the end of the show, but
I'm unfamiliar and don't know what we're talking about.
I have a new book out called Moonlight Serenades. It's available on Amazon. One of the stories in it is called Clown Town, and it's a it's a clown noir. It's,
now I feel like an asshole.
No, you're fine. it was just released like the other day. It's a world where social structure is based on what kind of clown you are. And a murder has happened in what is essentially the Cotton Club.
Wow.
And, yeah, so, like, not to put too fine a point on it, but Harlequins are, like, the 1%, and then there's, like, Auguste negatives and positives and rodeo clowns and scary clowns. And
well, that goes all the way back to the Italian tradition, doesn't it?
Exactly. In fact, one of the characters is based off a guy named Alicino Trevolino, is based on Italian clowns. But, anyway, it's in the new book.
I'm impressed.
Thanks.
But, Doctor, I am Pagliacci.
Exactly. And I don't want to say that. I was going to say, and it ends on a thing. But no. We're over an hour now. I was going to move on to some news real quick, and then we can.
Okay. Well, let's put a button on it. Let's put a punctuation on our film noir discussion. So we established we have this classic period, and that there's been permutations all through, and the 90s had a lot of that type of movie. What do we see now? Like, do we see
Heather Buckley being our future when it comes to making films of it?
Okay. Right. Didn't Alec Gillis just do a movie that's essentially monster noir?
Yeah, Fire City.
Yeah.
And then you have Nice Guys out now, everyone loves.
I'm looking forward to that picture.
People say it's totally
fine. Charles Hardy wrote the book for a hard case, so that definitely impresses me.
Yeah. God, I'm gonna get to that in a second. Literature-wise, Ed, I'm going to lean on you on this one. I've got a couple of names, Hammett, James M. Cain, Raymond Chandler, W.R. Burnett. Who do you think is critical reading?
Well, Jim Thompson, obviously.
Yeah, that guy never came up. Name keeps coming up. Never read him. I feel like an asshole.
Well, you should. It will improve your life.
I will do that.
Read The Killer Inside Me and A Swell-Looking Babe, and you'll be a happier person for it.
You know what's good to read, too, is Vashis. I mean, he's very close to Thompson's writing.
Well, I just read Gishler's Gun Monkeys. And something else. The New Lansdale. And so, go ahead, Ed.
Yeah, Lansdale's obviously deeply influenced by noir and writes noir. And again, I have to go back to his Western stuff. If you read The Thicket, which I think is one of the best American novels of the last 10 or 15 years, it's a straight-up Texas Western, but it is definitely noir.
Hmm.
There's also Blood and Bullets that I was reading on the plane to L.A. that Lansdale did.
Mm-hmm. I love just his use of language.
Yeah.
I just think it's so colloquial. It's like King. It's so colloquial that he just slips stuff by you. And it's,
yeah, that's East Texas. It's its own little world there.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So, Lansdale. There was a couple of names. I just saw one that had to do, God, I should have it in my under my hand, but I don't. I think I got rid of it. But it was like an absurdist noir where talking kangaroos and...
Well, shit, for that matter, read Kobo Abe.
Oh, or Hollow Chocolate... Hollow Chocolate Bunnies of the Apocalypse.
Okay.
Wherein everything is taking place in a town of toys.
Right.
And
well, I get absurdist fiction, but this is specifically there's like.
But this is good.
Okay.
It's not just an image. It's really there's a stuffed teddy bear who's a detective.
Okay.
It's really good.
All right. Any others? And
that makes me kind of wonder whatever happened to that film. I don't know if you guys are familiar with this, the Happy Town Murders.
No.
Oh.
This was a Jim Henson production that was supposed to be happening for some years now.
Yeah.
And I think it got tanked, but it was going to be a rated R film with all Muppets. That was a dark noir picture.
Wow. Now you blew my mind.
Oh, see, now that makes me think of Cool World.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ralph Bakshi is fantastic.
Yeah, Bakshi's... Yeah. lot of his
and even
stuff.
A lot of that stuff, the early stuff, the
Fritz the Cat.
Fritz the Cat. What was the other one?
It's one called. It's pretty politically correct. I think it's called Coontown.
Coontown.
Yeah,
that's
Coontown.
What I was thinking. Yeah.
A lot of that stuff. You know, there was a moment in my life where I was hiding out in...
You learn something new every day. I was on the lam from the law.
Yeah.
Hiding out in a really shitty hotel in Vegas. I won't say which one. And all I would do all night is, like, put on the jazz station and just sit and look out the window and watch the prostitutes, you know, and the drug dealers doing their deals. And just chain smoke all night. And I don't know why, but I would balance
that. You say that like it's unusual.
Well, I would balance that with, like, hopping in the car and just, you know, driving, you know, under neon for... And as crappy as it was to be doing what I was at the time, that brought me so much... joy.
Whole other life.
Just doing that.
Have you
sounds read, good to me.
Have you read Matthew Stokoe's High Life?
Oh, man, that's been on my Kindle for like 2 years, and
dude,
I still haven't read it yet.
I read it 100 pages or so, and I have to set it down and walk it off. It's brutal.
I was kind of thinking it was going to be a Selby-esque kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. It just sort of spins into this whole world where everyone's depraved and
well, that's the real world, man.
Yeah.
I was going to say that's like the presidential election. Or,
Yeah. Anyway, okay.
It's definitely on my list, I mean.
Yeah.
For real.
A friend of mine sent it to me with a sticky on it. He's like, out of all my friends, only you would appreciate this. And I thought, what?
I don't even remember who recommended that to me, but I bought it right away. But that's the problem with Kindles, is you acquire things, and they're not right in front of you.
Right.
So you open up your Kindle, and you got to search through it and go, shit, I've had that for 3 years.
Exactly. Or you just buy things on a whim, or
yeah.
You know, because a friend has it on sale or whatever. Well, okay. So we're going to buzz through some news stuff, and then we'll get out of here. Number one, Carpenter announced that he's coming back to the Halloween franchise. Is anyone here?
Heather, what do you think about that?
Let me see. Well, I do love John Carpenter, but I mean, he's just going to come back as executive producer. So it's Blumhouse getting another property. Halloween itself, though I saw a full cut of it very late in my life, holds up very well.
Absolutely.
And I don't know what else you could do with that series. Other series, like something like Friday, like Nightmare on Elm Street, I think there's a whole world of exploring, especially with our new CGI and makeup. I don't know what's left of Michael Myers, because he himself is the shape, and it's just a very simple story. He's a very simple monster.
Good point.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I couldn't care less.
But to note what I put on Twitter, which is they said who should direct it, and I said a female should direct it.
Yeah. That's our go-to female statement. Director, Lexi Alexander.
Heather Buckley.
I like to produce.
Yeah. You had talked earlier, Langley, about who's doing it now.
Right.
Funny you should mention that.
Aha!
MGM TV and Epix are bringing... I don't know how, but they're bringing Get Shorty to TV.
Oh.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of Westlake.
Yep. No talk on casting. No nothing. Just basically that they're doing it. The other one is...
Oh, this isn't, like, happening right now, but I would...
In the future.
I'd go back to True Detective.
Yeah.
It was...
Absolutely. Talk about Southern Noir.
Yeah.
True. It's the first season of... Is absolutely. Here's the one that's interesting, though. Back a few years ago, there was a little Australian film that not a lot of people talked about. The one woman got nominated for an Oscar for Best Supporting Actress. The movie's called Animal Kingdom. Russell Pierce was in it. It's about a family of real scumbags, 5 or 6 sons that all have this weird sort of almost Ryan Gosling and Only God Forgives attraction to the mother.
Okay.
And it's super cool, and it's super gritty, very noir, sort of an Australian noir kind of thing. But that's coming to TNT, so it's got some money behind it.
Wait. It's coming to TNT as in they're going to redo it as a series?
A series.
Oh, okay.
Ellen Barkin is going to play the mother.
I like her a lot.
I do too, but you know what? Time has not been kind.
No, stop.
I'm just
Time's
saying.
Time's not kind to anybody.
Yeah, it's not very kind to me either. So I miss my hair, I'm just saying.
Yeah, you and me both. Okay. Despite our best efforts, The Rock says the Big Trouble in Little China film is still happening.
God damn it.
You know, I like Dwayne Johnson, and I think that if he was cast well... which he almost never is, he could be a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
But almost everything he does is garbage, which is really sad. You know, I think he was born a generation too late. If we'd had him in the 80s, it would have been great. But there's just so much that doesn't necessarily need to be remade. You know, the nice thing about the 80s was you get movies like The Thing and The Fly and The Blob, where they took cheesy 50s pictures that are fun but really not that good,
mm-hmm.
and turn them into deep reflections of human nature.
Yeah.
And were actually better films. And so, you know, when people talk about, oh, remakes are terrible, I think actually not always. You know, there's some really terrific remakes.
Yeah. What's our theory about remakes, Tom? You find an old movie that was a good idea
that no one saw,
but was a bad movie for whatever reason.
Yes.
And give that story the chance it deserved in the first place.
You don't
place.
Remake Evil Dead or...
Well, the three examples I just gave are films I do,
exactly.
In fact, enjoy, but they're not very good movies. And the three remakes are good movies.
Are great movies, mm-hmm. yeah.
But, you know, when you take something that's already good, I mean, it's kind of a toss-up. You were talking about Michael Curtiz earlier. He did a picture, a horror picture in the 30s. It was a lot of fun. Called Mystery of the Wax Museum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was remade 20 years later with Vincent Price as House of Wax.
Charles Bronson.
If I'm put to the wire and I have to tell you which is a better film, I'm not really sure. I like them both quite a lot. And, you know, did Mystery of the Wax Museum need to be remade? I don't know if it needed to, but they did a good job.
Right.
However, in this day and age, you know, by and large, the remakes are not very good. So it's sensible that people are gun shy about it. Mm-hmm. And you take some, I mean, God, every Carpenter film has to be remade now.
Yeah. Right.
And have we seen a good one yet? I don't think so.
No. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, Halloween was fucking awful. And
you know what the best thing in that, the zombie, I think I said this on the show too, but the best
thing. And I like him.
Yeah. The first 10 minutes of Halloween 2 are perfect. And then then she wakes up from a dream and it goes right in the dumper.
The trouble with zombies' vision with Halloween, in my personal opinion, is that he tries to give a reason to Michael's evil. And the reason Carpenter did so well with that is there is no reason.
Right.
Right.
None. It's unknowable. It's ununderstandable. He's just born that way.
Mm-hmm.
Which makes it way more terrifying, whereas Zombie wants us to identify with Michael.
Right.
And it ruins the entire concept, I think.
Yeah, he's right. More effective as the nameless sort of faceless.
Yeah. We have no idea. It's a nice suburban middle class home. There's no reason for him to be like this. He just is.
Right.
And that's what Loomis says for
exactly
what five films until he finally died.
Right.
You know, he's just evil. Mm-hmm. Period. That's it.
Yeah. I again, Halloween heavily influenced by the Italian Giallo.
Mm-hmm.
Just gonna say, they released a new Star Trek trailer that doesn't look like Fast and the Furious.
You know, I didn't watch it. But I'm afraid.
Here's the one thing it looks like a fucking Star Trek movie, and no one
really cares.
Yeah, it just does. There's a lot of stuff flying through the air and whatever. But here's the interesting part: one of the writers of the script was Simon Pegg,
right?
And that now I suddenly am interested.
Did he have no part in the first two?
No, he was. He was Scotty in the first.
Yeah, but I mean, did he work on the screenplay?
No, okay. Just like supposedly he was on set for Force Awakens as a sort of.
I've heard that. Yeah.
Fact checker. You know.
Yeah.
I'm not a Star Wars fan, so I can't speak to that. But I am a huge Star Trek fan.
Okay.
And I'm. I think the first two reboots are goddamn awful.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Well, this new thing looks. Like, it's going to be exciting. There's going to be some shit flying, and there's going to be some gun battles, and I don't know what it all means. There's a new girl that they're introducing.
Some CGI crap flying around.
Sure.
No, boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, to me, Star Trek I think a lot of Trekkies or Trekkers, however they prefer it, completely miss the point of this franchise. I'm a fan of low sci-fi. I'm a fan of low fantasy as well. When they talk about high sci-fi, that's the shit where we're interested in the technology,
right?
And a lot of truckers are that way. They want to talk about how the ship works and all this kind of thing, and it's immaterial. It doesn't matter. What Star Trek is about is about humanity and a better future.
Mm-hmm.
It's a story about people. And,
right.
I always
thought of the original Star Trek as like a reflection of the UN.
Yes.
And all the other societies that we run into in these galaxies are basically a macrocosm of Earth and how we're dealing with clashing against these different cultures and things. I mean, it's very relevant today.
Right. Right.
And it was always developing. I mean, I think Roddenberry really fucked up in the original series because he had an entire planet, Planet Klingon, that was populated by an evil race,
mm-hmm.
Which is a ludicrous and honestly, if you apply it to Earth, kind of an offensive idea.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. But as the films developed, they and the new series, the Next Generation, developed. They fixed that.
Yeah, they made it more like samurai.
Yeah, it was a culture that has issues, but the people are not naturally evil. Nobody's naturally evil, and you know, as that series has or that franchise has gone on, they more and more developed this. I think great socialist message, if I can be kind of political about it. But I feel like Abrams has completely missed the boat on that.
Yeah. It's more about, you know, kicky, punchy, shoot of thing. Yeah.
Wow, I just nerded out. I'll be quiet for a minute.
No, you're fine. Okay. Ask me like that here. There was something else I wanted to say about that, and I don't remember what it was. Preacher premiered the TNT series.
Right, which I haven't seen.
I'm reading lots of good comments.
Yeah, I've read a lot that a lot of people, I read a good early review that one of the fans of the graphic novel liked it. So I'm optimistic, but cautiously.
Are you a fan, Ed?
I love the graphic novel series. I haven't seen the show yet. I'm curious if anybody knows, was Garth Ennis in any way involved with the show?
Yeah. Supposedly. That's what I remember reading. Rogan is just producing it, him and his production partner, who I had read a week ago. If Preacher works, their next project is The Boys.
Which would be great.
I heard about that. I love The Boys.
They couldn't possibly do that on AMC.
For Cinemax, it was actually posted on my wall that they want to do it for. And I watched Preacher last night, and I think unless you read the comic books, it's very confusing. The main character of Preacher didn't see that dynamic. But God damn it, Cassidy! And they're going to have Saint of Killers, which is so cool.
It
should be Sam Elliott, but...
100%, even though he's based on Lee Marvin and
Arnold. Yeah.
From what I understand, the first season of Preacher, or at least the lion's share of it, is something that we haven't seen in the graphic novel. We're going to be spending a lot of time with Jesse prior to what is it, Genesis, in his head, prior to that happening.
I don't have a problem with that. I really don't have a problem with film and TV deviating from the source material at all. I was just talking earlier to my friend here in town about the recent film Drive, which I think is, talking about noir, is just a terrific, pitch-perfect film.
Mm-hmm.
I was relating it to what I personally think is the best American film of the last 20 years, There Will Be Blood.
Oh, yeah.
It's a great movie.
And neither of those films are technically based on the source material so much as inspired by the source material.
Right.
And the directors just went off in their own direction and made their own thing. And what they made were great pieces of art.
Mm.
So I really don't have a problem. If it works, I don't have a problem with artists taking source material and doing their own thing. And so when I do get around to Preacher, if it deviates from Menace's work, I have no issue with that, as long as it's good.
Yeah.
I think that's almost even a better situation, because you wind up with two completely different experiences.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly, sure.
So you've got, sometimes you need to follow, say for example, Shawshank Redemption. If Shawshank Redemption hadn't followed the story, it would have sucked. And that's what happens to a lot of King movies, is that they deviate too far from the story, and they don't add anything to it. They're not making it better. They're just making it different.
And yeah, I'm still on the fence about the ending of Darabont's Mist, but. I get what you're saying.
Yeah, we talked about that.
Yeah,
the end of The Mist, that is not earned that ending, 100%.
Yeah.
We argue about this a lot.
Give us your take.
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah. I love the novella, and I think that the film is surely one of the best horror pictures we've had in many years, in terms of American studio horror films, and one of the very best King adaptations. I think it's pretty much perfect, but that ending really bothers me a lot, for a lot of reasons. But I think just as a storyteller, the main reason that bothers me is that I think King's ending is so much better, because it's open, and you don't know what's going to happen. They're writing off into the sunset. You have no idea how widespread this issue is, how far it goes, what the end is.
Do you think that its films need to button everything up?
Well, I think...
Well, Hollywood's need, not necessarily film's need, sure.
Yeah, Hollywood.
Well, but I would argue that there's a lot of films that kind of end with an open ending like that it does not satisfy.
Yeah.
Like the way that a book would, a book, because it's more of it's a longer experience and it gives me a chance to think. Personally, I love the ending to The Mist because it hits me in the bread box.
Oh, it's wretched. So ugly
and
it's brutal.
So, exactly. And I think that is why I like it, because it makes me... I think it's a much more realistic movie.
I will say for that ending that was the moment that I realized that Thomas Jane is amazing.
Mm. Yeah.
And he needs to be better utilized.
Agreed. Speaking of Noir, they did... what was the one that... Shit.
The one that shit?
No, that Tim Bradstreet was on.
That was a dream catcher.
It was just... Keep talking.
We can talk about dream catchers.
It wasn't...
What about those shit we
One of my best mates from high school used to be friends with Tim Bradstreet. And ended up on the... What was that character? Cal something? He was a supernatural detective?
Cal McDonald?
Yeah.
That's a Steve Niles thing.
Yeah, and Tim Bradstreet did some covers for that.
Yeah.
And this friend of mine, who is now a successful lawyer in Little Rock, Arkansas, Ben Barham. Hey, Ben. I'll have to tag him when this goes up. Was on the cover of one of those as Cal McDonald.
Oh, wow. Yeah. The film I was talking about was Dark Country. It was Thomas Jane directed it.
I've never heard of this.
Couple en route from Las Vegas are forced to deal with a body out in the desert, making their honeymoon a hellish ride. And then shortly thereafter, or right around the same time, he did a movie called Give Him Hell Malone.
I haven't heard of that either.
Russell Mulcahy directed. Tough as Nails private investigator squares off with gangsters. Both
nice.
Of them, right around 2009, are great.
That one has been... what's his name? Bing
Rhames,
yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Haven't seen him in a while.
Yeah, I think he'll be making Fast and Furious movies until
is he in those? I've never seen one.
Up until the time they let him do another fucking Riddick movie.
No, that's...
Oh, that's Vin Diesel.
Vin Diesel.
Yeah. Bing Rhames. Mark,
those are all things
why you shouldn't drink,
watch.
Kids. All right.
Just say no.
Yeah, I know. Real quickly, they had announced an exclusive deal today between Disney, Marvel, Lucasfilm, Pixar, and Netflix. Netflix will be the exclusive streaming service for all of those studios' catalogs.
Yeah,
just say no to capitalism, kids.
I know. Yeah, part of me doesn't care because most of those...
Well, I don't know what it... There was nothing said in the article I read about what it's going to do. Because Disney has the smartest fucking model ever. Release a film to DVD, let it enjoy its time in the marketplace. When the sales start to slack off, you pull it, you put it back in the vault, you wait 10 years, and you release it again.
Yeah.
And the same people that bought it the first time, because you're going to put some other bonus material on
right.
are going to buy it again.
But it's so predatory, though.
I know.
I know
it's horrible, especially when you have kids. But
thank goodness I don't. You should all be happy for that.
But how streaming works is that it's always available. Are they going to cycle that?
I don't know.
But it means that all of the versions of the Star Wars movies will be streamable. It'll be all of the Pixar movies. It's a fairly big deal.
I mean, it's a big deal, but... I don't know. I mean, it just seems to me like one more step towards, you know, one giant monopoly controlling all of our entertainment.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what they have.
But I'll always have my movies on VHS and they can never have them.
Right.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing about streaming, that it should be more democratic. There are so many streaming services.
Right.
And they let us see more, you know, smaller films.
Exactly.
That are wonderful. You know, that's how I saw Cop Car, which I thought was one of the best films last
year. Yeah, it's a great movie.
I mean, it did do some theater engagements, but not a lot. I mean, well, obviously, that kind of picture is going to do a lot more business streaming. But, you know, when something like Netflix and Amazon take over that entire business, then they just ruin the democratic nature.
Well, here's a couple of things. Number one, Netflix, most of these streaming services, they're awash in one-star horror films and really just shit.
Oh, sure.
Shouldn't be involved. And I lost number two. Shit. All right. I'm getting tired. It's old. Yeah. I do want to mention, today they announced, Michael Gingold announced that he's leaving Fangoria.
And, I saw that, yeah.
And we all love Michael here. And
we love him. He's a good friend to us in New York City. All his friends love him.
Yeah. And the whole thing, but I don't know anything about how it all went down, but I just know that it's pretty shitty from everything I do here. And I'm sure he's going to land in someplace better and more nurturing than Fangoria was.
I don't have I don't have horses in this race the way you guys do, because you guys have both written for Fangoria, and it's been probably a bigger part of your life than it has ever been for me. But I can't see the model that they've been doing continuing. I was, to be honest, when I first met you and found out you wrote for Pink Rip, I didn't know the magazine still existed. I had thought it had gone away the way Starlog and Omni.
It's a different world, to be sure.
Sure.
Online is different. People now by the hour, not by the month.
Right.
But
did you just quote the Bible?
Did I?
That sounded like it. I don't know.
But I think that the thing that makes this important, number one, is A, it sort of highlights what kind of pieces of shit those people are.
Right.
But also, is it sort of a death knell for print?
Well, they've been talking about that for 10 years.
Yeah, I mean, newspapers are going away. Magazines are all going online.
Right.
And nobody's getting paid. Wee.
Yeah.
That's the biggest thing. That's
the problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've talked about that a lot.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I don't know. I just know that it feels like a part of my past is sort of
sure.
It's having like, the book closed on it unceremoniously.
It's like when Famous Monsters went away, you know.
Yeah, but then they came back.
Harry Knowles brought it back, LOL.
Right. Yeah, well, exactly. That's what I mean, is that, you know, if it goes
shout out thing, to Austin, you asshole.
It'll come back, but it won't. It's kind of like the animals that come back from the pet cemetery. They come back, but they're not quite the same.
Yeah. Is Fangoria still based out of Canada?
No. I guess not. Heather, do you know? It's New York, right?
Fangoria?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, now because of the new editor-in-chief, it's out of Jersey. But, yes, it was out of New York City in the office, and I think their head is over in Long Island.
Because Chris Alexander did everything from
out of Toronto, yeah.
Right.
But then you had international contributors.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I thought it was actually Toronto based in the Alexander years.
So that's Rue Morgue. Rue Morgue is Toronto based.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so is Fango. Fango was during Chris's reign. They both were.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
And Chris worked for Rue Morgue, as did the wonderful Yvonne.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not a complete idiot.
Real quickly, let's go around the table, and then we're done. What we've been watching, anything that we've seen. We'll go to Ed first.
You know, honestly, I'm such a grumpy old man, and I avoid things that are new, for the most part.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
My entire viewing lately has been stuck in the 1930s, so I've been watching Buster Keaton and Marx Brothers and horror pictures like Supernatural I just watched with Carol Lombard, which was quite a lot of fun. However, and and it almost pains me to admit this because I absolutely loathe the superhero trend. I angrily loathe the superhero trend.
Right.
But I watched Deadpool.
Yes.
Great fun. Great fun. Ryan Reynolds is charming as hell. And it was a funny movie. It was an engaging movie. And if I ever watch another superhero film, it'll be the sequel to that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially they're doing a lot of fun things casting-wise. They're playing with Cable and who's going to be that. Ron Perlman is up for it.
Hopefully, yeah.
The main bad guy in Avatar is up for Cable. Yeah, they're talking about a lot of.
I'd love to see Perlman. I love the Hellboy pictures, and I wish Del Toro could have made a third one, but nobody went and watched them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But they're terrific.
Yeah.
They are terrific.
Okay, that's fair. Heather?
Well, I was eating salad. I think I watched 5 minutes of an Anthony Bourdain show.
Yeah.
Yes.
He just interviewed Obama in Vietnam, and it looked crazy.
It is, and people are complaining that he's smug and he's not friendly. I said he's a punk rock guy from the New York, New Jersey area.
Yeah. Have you read Kitchen Confidential?
None of it. I have not. Because of the day job, it's impossible to do anything. That's why I was amazing.
Guy is something.
You goddamn Yankees.
Yeah.
To hit play on my laptop. I haven't had a chance to watch.
All right. That's fair enough. Langley?
The most recent thing I watched was unfortunately, I can't remember the title of it, but it was a documentary all about Legos.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I saw it. It's on Netflix.
Yeah, it's really good. It explore. Personally, I don't care, but I love that they address the history and how Legos are being used by different people for different things.
Right.
They're being used as tools for learning things, and what I most enjoyed about it is they explore the whole world of stop-motion Lego.
With Legos, yeah, it's huge. Absolutely. Yeah.
Did they have a segment about stepping on Legos?
They did not have a segment about stepping on Legos.
They should have.
But, you know, you don't have kids, Ed, so why are you stepping on Lego? I know that pain, because I have a kid, but why do you?
Because I'm from Arkansas and I don't wear shoes.
There you go. Me, I'm still doing my 366 and 366. They're all up on my website at tomcarnell.com. Some of the titles this week, Jaume Balaguero, who did Wreck, a movie called Fragile with Calista Flockhart. It's a hospital ghost story. Perfect Host with David Hyde Pierce.
Great movie. Great movie.
Oh, yeah. Terrific.
Afterlife, After Dot Life with Christina, a very hot Christina Ricci and Liam Neeson being a real creeper.
Also great,
yeah. At first, I got it confused with, there's a Koreeda movie, a Japanese film called Afterlife that is one of my favorite films of all time.
Oh, wow.
But this is something completely different. Day of the Cobra with Franco Nero. Hands of the Ripper, a late latter-day Hammer movie, and then a Filipino horror film like The Ring called T2 that I stumbled upon. So that's that. Go to my website. They're all up there, all 145 so far.
Go to Amazon and check out Moonlight Serenade.
We're getting there.
Okay.
Ed,
yes,
tell us how we can get your stuff. Your website is edkurtzbooks.com.
Yes, it is, and there's a comprehensive list there of books and stories that you can find. A few of the stories are free. You can find them online, or just, you know, search me on Amazon, Ed Kurtz.
Yeah, and when does the new book come out?
The new book is out in September from Cheezine out of Toronto, which is an absolutely terrific publisher, kind of a coup for me. Called the Rib From Which I Remake the World. It'll it's very noir-y. It's a noir horror fantasy Luciferian magic and freaks and the circus, and it's great fun.
All right.
It sounds awesome.
I need this in my life.
You do.
Heather, what are you up to?
Things for Red Shirt that I can't even talk about, of course.
Cool.
They're so cool. I was in upstate New York interviewing a legendary actor for a cool thing today when all the horror, you know, came down about Fango. So I was trying to, like, drive and not look at my phone that was exploding all over the place. So there's that. Next week, unless I get this gig that I'm up for, a feature thing, that I will be going to Michigan with Mr. Mike Felcher and then going to Kentucky or Arkansas, something like that, for Wonderfest. Somewhere down south for Wonderfest so I can get my rondo with Mike.
Yeah, that'll be cool.
Yes.
And I'll wear a Bob Mackie gown. Actually, I'll just, like, wear studded vest jack boots, but that's
I want to one day see Heather Buckley in a Bob Mackie gown.
I always would say at the Chainsaw Awards, I want to wear a Bob Mackie gown.
That's awesome. You?
Going to be much like yourself, doing a bunch of panels at Crypticon this weekend in Seattle.
Yes.
Terrific.
One of which is near and dear to my heart. I'll be talking about the Hart brothers and their reign of terror in the 1700s in Western Kentucky and Southern Illinois, my old stomping grounds.
Right on.
So that's going on. I'm stuff of interest to listeners of the show. I don't have a lot going on right now because I've been focusing on trying to get this grown up job, which if I do, I hope provides fodder for,
stuff
that you would be more interested in.
Right on. Moonlight Serenades is on Amazon. 17 stories. There's some reprints. There's Clown Town. There's three Cleese pieces, which is the hero from the other book. It's a way of salvaging some stuff that got written for the sequel that is never going to happen. Langley did the cover.
Says you.
Nah, no, I can. It's a zombie thing, and I think we're done with zombies for about 10 years at least. And I'm old, so I'll be long dead. Moonlight Serenades is from Crossroad Press, and David and those guys have been great.
I did want to say, if you haven't gotten a subscription to Stop Motion Magazine and you care at all, do it. You'll see my work in there. It's a really good magazine that focuses on, go figure, stop motion. Yeah.
Of all things.
So, and then please find the show on, Ed, you're on Twitter?
I'm not on Twitter. Nice. Maybe I should get back. I don't know.
No, probably not.
You should totally get on Twitter.
Yeah, Twitter's great for the promotion of your shit. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, I embarrass myself on social media.
Yeah.
Much like real life.
You're one of my favorite follows on Facebook.
Thank you.
So there.
you must be a bitter bastard.
Hey, anyone that makes me laugh, I'm all for. Find the show on Facebook and we're on at Bonus Show on Twitter. I'm on Twitter. Heather's on Twitter. Langley's not on Twitter, but we're all on Facebook.
I'm also on Instagram if you want to see my adventures.
There we go. Uh-oh. Ed, thanks a lot for coming on.
Thank you for having me. It's been great fun.
You are welcome back anytime. I want to do a Giallo show, and I think you're my guy.
Oh, yes.
All right.
Again, you're talking my language.
All right. All right. So, for the Bonus Material Podcast, I'm Tom Carnell.
I'm Heather Buckley.
And I'm Langley West. Stay scared.